Hello everyone, this is Maurizio, Editor-in-Chief of Power Electronics News, and welcome to NI Connect, showing in Austin, Austin Convention Center, Texas, United States. I have the pleasure to be here together with Ritu Favre, Group President of Emerson Test and Measurement Business. Hi Ritu, thanks a lot for your time, how are you?
I'm great, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks a lot. So Ritu, your career covers over three decades in industry. Yesterday, during the keynote, you paid homage to the story of National Instruments, NI, 50 years. Dr. T, LabVIEW in 1986, more or less. So LabVIEW is a part of my art. I worked a lot with LabVIEW. That is became a cover store of National Instruments software sending approach to test, as you said yesterday. Also very known in terms of data acquisition and control system, because we should commercialize the device, but we need to test. This is important for every industry. So how have you seen technology evolved during this time? What emerging trends do you believe will significantly impact the industry in the coming years?
Yeah, so again, 30 years in the industry. And as you saw in the keynote this morning, as Kevin was showing, we started with the transistor, then it went to ICs, then it became PCs, then the internet came, and now we're in the AI revolution. So kind of the key mega trends that we're seeing is wireless. So if you look at 5G, 6G, even one day there'll be 7G, the ongoing changes to the connectivity standards. So that's a big place that we're looking to invest in. The other big one is sustainability. So everything about kind of power and how do we conserve power and just overall sustainability kinds of trends. And so that plays out in EV in the way that we're looking at it. The other big thing, of course, is AI. AI is disrupting absolutely everything. And the way we think about that is, as you go forward, you have to embrace AI. It's the next trend that's coming around, you know, the corner. But people are still trying to figure out how exactly that's going to work. The other thing that I'm seeing from a semiconductor perspective is that semiconductor and automotive is becoming much more coupled together, particularly through software. So cars are becoming software defined. They have a lot of semiconductors in them. So that's another big trend that's happening from an automotive perspective. We see a lot kind of in the aerospace defense. So if you look at nationalization and what's happening around the world geopolitically, that's a mega trend that's not really technology, but it is something that's shaping the way technology is going into the world.
Great. So as a leader driving growth in semiconductor, but in electronics engineering in general, okay, what strategies are crucial for staying ahead in the market? So considering the rapidly changing of technology, so you mentioned also AI, 5G, 6G, and so on, but how do you balance meeting current customer needs while preparing for the next future?
Yeah, so I would say if you look at it from being in tech, it depends on what part of tech you're in. And I is I said this yesterday, we're a truly unique company because we are at the forefront of any new technology that comes out. And so if there's some new trend, if there's some new capability, we end up having to help test. So a lot of our strategy is to look at the mega trends and then adapt rapidly. And because we have a flexible, modular, software-centric approach, customers can use our tools, our products, our solutions, and they can rapidly evolve them based on the new technology. So the really cool thing about NI's strategy is that our platform allows customers to do whatever they want depending on what's happening in the technology. So really our strategy is to maintain that flexible, open, modular approach so that no matter what's happening in the market, our customers are able to use that technology.
Great. So you are actively involved in initiatives supporting diversity and leadership in technology, such as the Global Semiconductor Association Women Leadership Council. So tell me more about this one. What initiative have you found most effective for women to pursue a career in industry?
Yeah, so I mean, as you said, I've been in the industry for 35 years, and in the industry that I'm in, I'm an electrical engineer by training. There was about 5 women in my class. And so as I've come up through the ranks, it you do learn that there are some barriers as you continue to go. So part of, and semiconductor is a very difficult industry to be in. I mean, there's a lot of engineering. There's not that many women in semiconductor. So I joined the Global Semiconductor Association Women's Leadership Initiative to encourage women to be in semiconductor. First of all, most women don't want to be in a bunny suit in a wafer fab. And so it's how do you make it look like an exciting career? And that's a lot about what we do there. So a lot of the initiatives are, how do you get women to go into engineering fields? First of all, it's very difficult to encourage girls, especially in the United States, to do math and science. So there's sort of a lot of girls think, oh, that's hard, I don't want to do that. So it's how do you get girls into math and science? How do you get them into an engineering kind of a degree? How do you convince them or encourage them to go into semiconductor? Those are all very, very hard things to do. Then the interesting part is once you get into a semiconductor field, it's so difficult in those companies that then it's how do you keep women in semiconductor? Because there's many women that will spend 5 years, 10 years and say, this is really hard. I have no work-life balance. I'm working all the time. And then they leave. So a lot of what GSA is trying to do is get girls into math and science, get them into engineering careers, get them to go into semiconductor, and then stay in semiconductor. So those are all the initiatives. Yeah. My background is semiconductor physics, so I am like deeply, deeply into the physics of semiconductors.
Great. So talking about young women, as you said, so if you, from your career, if you would give an advice, a suggestion, just one, maybe that would follow career in technology, what you would suggest, your advice?
I think the biggest thing is to be resilient and be very patient and just keep going, no matter what. Like, the biggest thing I've always told girls, women, is make sure you find your voice, because it's so difficult to exact change, to move things forward, particularly as a woman. And so it's, don't give up, keep going, find a different way to say it, find your voice, and just keep pushing.
Super. So young people, young students are important for the future of the industry, of course. So these are the next workforce. So how do you see the intersection between industry, schools, university in preparing the next workforce for the future that should take care of the advancements in technology?
Yeah, I think it's very important for universities to keep up with the emerging trends. So as we were saying, NI is always sitting at the forefront of these emerging trends. Universities must be at the forefront, and then the curriculum needs to adapt very quickly. So if you look at AI today, the way that universities will have to work on that curriculum is going to have to change. I mean, every 6 months it's changing. And so really coming up with how do the universities train students so that they can come into industry, I think apprenticeships and internships are really important. And then getting people into industry and then keeping them there so that they're able to adapt and learn. It's a truly exciting time to be in the industry right now. It's just changing so fast. And so it's universities need to partner with industries and make sure that everybody is keeping pace with the how quickly technology is evolving.
Great. Thanks a lot, Ritu. Thanks a lot for joining me in this interview. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.